Please note that though this is a spoiler-free review of the subject, I do spoil the series and/or franchise leading up to this particular entry. Put off by how long this video is, don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. If the video is too long for you, I have recorded a shorter version and the link will be in the description box. X-Men Movie Review. The world is becoming more familiar with mutants living among them. Mutants are basically human beings with powers of various kinds, and some of them are very powerful, and some people, including some politicians, are growing scared. And there is even talk of a mutant registration act. A war is coming between mutants and regular people, and we meet almost a dozen mutants in this. Some of them believe that humans and mutants can peacefully coexist, and some refuse to believe that, and some of those are very dangerous, and we're going to see these two groups fight. From here on out, I'm going to be referring to non-mutants as sapiens, as in Homo sapiens, and mutants as superior, as in Homo superior. And that's not because I necessarily believe that, you know, in the fictional world of mutants, of Marvel, that mutants are superior. But that's, you know, such is the language, and it's much easier to, if I have specific words. Originally, this movie was going to open with more scenes of mutant powers manifesting. I'm really glad that it ended up the way it did. As it is, there are only two such scenes. One of them is we see the brutal, inhuman treatment of Jews during the Holocaust, and we see it scar this kid, and this child actor, young, I don't know, he looks to be in his early teens, but this young actor does an amazing job. When he looks at these you know, his fellow Jews being so mistreated, there's not just hurt, fear, and pain in his eyes. There's genuine rage. There is righteous fury. He finds it abhorrent that anyone would treat human beings like this. And yeah, he doesn't have very much screen time, and he says very little, but his eyes are screaming out. And this child grows up to be the villain of this film. Magneto, who, it's, there's a, It's interesting and telling that he, having been abused at the hands of Nazis, basically becomes one himself. He is one of the people who would use the term superior. He genuinely believes that mutants are better than humans, and that he doesn't say as much in this, but in the comics certainly he genuinely believes that mutants should rule. In this, it seems, in this he just very clearly, he doesn't say that mutants should rule, but he does speak of sapiens in very, in terms that he, one of the first things he says about sapiens is they no longer matter. And it's suggested to him that mankind has evolved since the Holocaust. And he says, yes, they've evolved into us. And yeah, it really says something about how conflict begets conflict, hatred begets hatred, and violence begets violence. And I'm gonna stop now before I go full Yoda. The other of these two scenes is what may be the first kiss that this young woman, Marie, shares with her boyfriend. And when she does, it clearly, I'm not going to give away exactly what it does, but it clearly really hurts him. And that, you know, that's part of why the Marie, and also known as Rogue, was chosen for this, because it doesn't get much more alienating than that. You express positive feelings towards another person, someone that you trust, that you're comfortable with, and the result is, you know, yeah, it's you know, how can you be around other people? How can you feel comfortable in your own skin when something like that happens? And not only is she tremendously relatable, she is one of our two protagonists. These are two of the most important characters to understand in the whole film. And both of them have to deal with this tremendous amount of pain, this real, you know, I'm not saying that it's the same, but they have both found themselves set apart from the rest of the world, from sapiens, and we see them, you know, handling their pain very differently. And it really goes into xenophobia. And in addition to Magneto having become basically a supremacist, him having become a supremacist, you know, there's also just the, there's the whole Mutant Registration Act. Is he clearly believes that it is the first step to, he would say, another Holocaust. And, you know, if you cry Godwin's Law, let's just say that some would, you know, some superior would think that it would at least lead to them being singled out and mistreated, abused. Opening during the Holocaust also immediately removes any idea in the audience that this is going to be a light film. And I would argue that it doesn't, the Holocaust is not just used for, like, shock value, which whenever someone uses it in fiction, it's going to have some, you know, the shock value is part of it. But Yeah, it's trying to create a parallel of all of the many comic book adaptation movies. This had one of the most difficult, one of the most difficult jobs in the world building. It has to the world in this movie is very close to our own world. An exact year is not given, but it says the not too distant future. And going by some of the later films, you could basically say it's set when it was made, and that goes for several of these, not all, not the ones very specifically set, decades ago, but the main ones before they started going back. And it has to make us believe that these fantastical powers could exist in our world. And this is for various reasons. They were worried that it would not be taken seriously if it wasn't fairly close to our world. The idea and the effect of exploring the xenophobia, you might say it's easier for people to go along with, to when you go into themes like that. Usually, either you go into really, very, very complex themes, or you do a movie with, people who have powers, and an action movie, a, and the movie has to do both, so it does have to, and part of it is also budget and whether it was really something that they believed could work, the studio and such, and there are also a lot of characters in this, a lot of major characters that you have to know what, basically you should leave the movie with some idea of who they are. And I would say on all of them, some idea at least. And then it has to introduce all of these different powers. And the powers aren't really necessarily linked. Like the basic idea, the common thread is that they're all, homo superior. They're all basically, it's genetic. They have something in their DNA. I believe in the comics it's referred to as the X gene. Yeah. Because comic books. I love comic books. They have something in their DNA that gives them this power. But when you compare to other group films, the Fantastic Four, although their powers are very different from each other, they got them at the same time and in the same way. So once you've gotten that out of the way, okay, there are these people who have powers, and other than that, that movie can exist in our world. But here's a world where people of very different generations, like I said, this is basically set today, when it's set in 2001 when it came out. 2000, 2001. And one of our characters was a teenager during the Holocaust. So some of these people have had powers for more than half a century. Some have the DNA for that. for so long, and yet it's still more or less our world. So we have to believe that they haven't, you know, like, if there are several that are that old, then why hasn't the Mutant Registration Act been passed long ago, for example? And I would say the movie explains. Yeah, it's not really a spoiler. Basically, they keep more or less of a low profile. I get the sense, at least, that Magneto hasn't done a lot between then and now. Not a lot of really high profile stuff. But now, with the mutant registration, he's going to make his big move. It's the because now it is necessary. This is, you know, he sees it as the first step to, you know, at the very least, segregation. And which, you know, in and of itself is pretty horrible. So now he's doing, and that's also part, you know, the film has to make us believe that after that happened, that the world wouldn't, you know, they weren't going to make the second movie. You know, it's not a spoiler to say one of the later movies did actually say, okay, well, a long time into the future, this is what the world is going to look like. They weren't going to do that with the second movie, you know. So they had to also make it plausible that after the events of this movie, that the world would still look close to what it does today. Just, again, with with the superior. I'm gonna use homo superior from now on. So as to not cause confusion. While the X-Men are huge in the Marvel Universe, and thus in comics, you know, Marvel being one of the two big ones, the other being DC, they're a pretty big deal. If you read comic books, you know them. If you know anything about comic books, you know at least something about the X-Men. But if you've never picked up a comic book before this movie, and, you know, so, well, some, of course, found out about it during, you know, from the 90s Saturday morning cartoon. But if you don't watch Saturday morning cartoons, yeah. So this had to introduce this entire world to the mainstream. This is a mainstream movie. This is not some small little that can afford to be strange or no, this had to really, and you know, as examples, everybody knows Batman, Superman, Spider-Man, you know, and this is, yeah, you know, cultural osmosis, basically. But the X-Men, there's so many characters, so many powers, the so much has changed and happened over the decades. You know, they were created in the early 60s, so yeah. And the movie very smartly opens with some of the first and most pertinent questions for those not familiar with the comics. What are homo superior? Should I be worried about them? How will the rest of the world react to learning about their existence? Are they good? Are they evil? Are there some on either side? If any of them are good, what are the problems that they face? Who are the leaders of the different factions, and what relationship do they have with one another? And yeah, it really beautifully, very early and without overwhelming the audience, part of it, you know, introduces all of this, and you get a real sense of the world. And part of it is that it does, of course, draw on other big political, you know, there's some McCarthyism to the mutant registration, the way it's pushed for by one senator, we see especially. And yeah, some of his language is very McCarthyan, and some of the, yeah, you know, it draws parallels and thus helps us to accept. And yeah, it really convinces us that this is a world very similar to our own. And it explores these themes. There's social commentary. I have not watched App Pupil, although I do appreciate the irony in casting that Ian McKellen went from being an actual Nazi to being a character who was persecuted by Nazis. Nor have I watched anything that Bryan Singer has made after this movie that did not involve costumed characters. When this first came out, I didn't watch it in theaters because I hardly watched anything in theaters. There were, like, I think from 97 to 2003. I came back just in time for the Matrix sequels and Terminator 3. It's pretty amazing that I didn't right then say, okay, never mind, I'm not going to the movies anymore. But yeah, there were some years there where I didn't really go to the movies. I also didn't watch the second one in theaters. But the moment that this came out on VHS, I distinctly remember, you know, going through the store and seeing the display where they, you know how they stack a bunch and, you know, they'll have the big cardboard standee. Went right up, grabbed one immediately, went up and paid for it, went right home, watched it immediately. I think I might have watched it several times in a row, even that first day. Then I went on to, for at least a few months, watch it at least once per day. I made sure that I made time in my day to watch it at least once. Then when I never did get the DVD of the regular one, but I have watched it, and the special features on it, but I'm quite happy with my purchase. I instead got the 1.5 DVD, and then I watched the special features countless times and really delved deep into it. And on that DVD, both in the special feature, you know, the documentaries and such, and you know, there are actual deleted scenes. You know, you can watch the movie with deleted scenes. You, in the documentaries, you see some of these scenes being filmed and such, and sometimes it's just short clips of these scenes that you see, but they're quite interesting. It's that typical thing of, you know, I see why they cut it, but I'm glad I saw it. And yeah, basically, this is a movie I took to right away, and not just because I know and love so much of the source material. I've mentioned before the I am that cliche teenage guy who, you know, yeah, you know, going through typical teenage stuff, pick up an X-Men comic, fall in love with, you know, get into the character of Wolverine, and, you know, was reading the comics from then on out. Another reason I took to this right away is that it just had such an uphill battle. And it came out a good to great movie. I'm not going to claim that the whole thing is amazing, but there are elements in here that are amazing, uncanny even, and yeah, there are some elements that are, you know, that aren't, and I am going to try to be honest about both, but Yeah, in spite of the elements that aren't as good, and in spite of just how much this had to deal with, it came out a good to great film, and that is very impressive. The Batman movies of Joel Schumacher. Joel Schumacher is one of those names where just it's not the actual letters or words to his name. It's his work that makes it difficult to say his name without sighing. Joel Schumacher's Batman movies made Hollywood really afraid of taking, basically, of adapting comics in a, translating them directly, of saying this works really well in comic books. Let's get as much of it as we can into the movie. So, big colorful costumes. Certain, the very specific names and words. People and beings and such that very clearly do not exist in our world. Fantastical things such as alien, fighting aliens, going to other planets, traveling through time, alternate dimensions, all of these things, creating a world of their own. This, these are things that comic books can really dive deep into, but that for movies, part of it is the whole diegetic and kind of, when you look at something that's been filmed, when you're watching a live action film, we tend to believe that that's, well, that's based, I mean, it's practically a documentary. What I'm looking at is real. What I'm looking at really happened. And when you have elements in there that we have a hard time accepting as real, that makes, that means that there's some chance that the movie isn't, excuse me, isn't going to work, that we're not going to accept what we see. And when you then have a lot of these different elements in there, which is why they built to that. They didn't go to time travel right away. They didn't go to giant robots right away. Comic books can, because we accept that it's, there are different expectations for the medium. And this is not passing judgment on either medium or any medium. Spoonie, in his review of X-Men Origins Wolverine, he talks about the X-Men in general, and he points out, in the comics, the X-Men fight, these 20-story tall robots and such, and like I said, that didn't happen in the movies for a while. The 90s Saturday morning cartoon, there's one of those, one of these robots, a sentinel, right there in the first minutes of the pilot episode. There are just completely different expectations, and there they also do have the colorful costumes and such. So yeah, a lot of these things are toned down or changed altogether. And a lot of the things I've just mentioned as working in comic books. I will say that when you look at what the characters wear when not in uniform, when not on a mission, they get that fairly right for most of the characters. Which, you know, that's also somewhere where you have more freedom, because it is casual wear, you know, so yeah. But they could have, you know, if they didn't care, the creative minds on this could have just said, they wear what everybody else wears. I don't need to see their personality there. I don't need the comic reflected there. And that's not what happened. They actually did put effort in. Now, the uniforms themselves, I get it. In comic books, the idea is they should look unique. They should be really expressive. You should get a real sense of who is this from what they're wearing. They should look iconic. They should be, you know, you should be able to quickly recognize them, so that, you know, when you're reading a comic book, when you're going through, maybe there's a fight scene, maybe there are dozens of characters that, you know, that doesn't happen every comic book, but some, you know, there are comic books where that happens. The idea is you don't get bogged down sitting there trying to catch small little details that are different. No, you look at them, the color scheme, the design, immediately, okay, that's that character, moving on. As an example, the badass who, you know, keeps to himself, and yeah, he wears bright yellow and blue. So yeah, that's, you know, they're not gonna do that in this, but in the comics we completely accept that. But this is an adaptation, and getting, you know, just ditching the comic costumes almost completely just really irks us fans, and us fans are why the movie is being made at all. If people hadn't been reading them consistently for decades, you know, I mean, there are tons of comics that, you know, that don't have a really big audience, and yeah, those aren't as commonly adapted. You know, so yeah. The way I see it, they should basically just try to use subtler versions that, you know, some of which are in the comics, and tone down the colors the way the MCU did later. I'm not saying that this movie could have done what the MCU movies did. This in part laid the groundwork for the MCU to even exist, and I greatly appreciate. Yeah, but nevertheless, they shouldn't have gone this far in a different direction. Some of the toned down ones work really well. I really like Sabretooth's look in this, although there are elements to it that I'll get to those. Basically, he wears this big coat, and then he wears, not all the time, but some of the time, he wears this full pelt of what may very well be a wolf. He killed this thing. He skinned it for practice, because he could, because he wanted to, with his bare hands. That tells you so much about the character, and just fits. And that's also, you know, people do wear fur, you know, so this is one case where fur literally is murder. Yeah, what they largely did was that the uniforms are kind of these nondescript, very, you know, simple kind of, and yeah, it's annoying for those of, and I'm not sure it was a huge treat for people who went in blind either. Some of the costume things some of it they try to justify, and it just opens up plot holes that didn't need to be there. Xavier, the incredible powerful telepath in this, tries to find, explains that he cannot find Magneto because of Magneto's helmet, trying to explain, and, this is, again, as someone who loves the comics, I'm not going to click. Magneto's helmet is essentially a bucket with a capital T for, the eyes and the mouth and nose and such. And again, when you see that, you immediately recognize it. And in comic pages, it's not gonna bother people, but the moment that you put that, so they felt they had to explain it. And I do really appreciate they actually did put the helmet on him. That, it doesn't look exactly the way it did in the comics. I'm really glad they... Early on in the comics, his helmet had horns. I get what they were going for. He is the bad guy, but that really... They tried to do that in one of the later films, and it just did not work at all. But what he wears in this... It's slightly toned down, but it does more or less match what he wears in the comics. But yeah, they felt the need to explain that it blocks the telepathy from Xavier. But what about the other? He has three henchmen. Why can't Xavier find those? And if you had never said it, if you hadn't had a line about why he couldn't find Magneto, then we would pretty much just have accepted, okay, he can't find them. You don't have to explain everything that you can't do. That, if no one brings it up, then we can just, there's a chance we don't think of it at all. But also, I mean, if you're going to sit down and explain every single limitation of every single, there are things in this where we're not told exactly how something happened, but we can piece it together. We can theorize, and it makes sense that they got there. And, another thing is, again, another of the... things that really work in comics are these names. In the comic books, Magneto calls his group the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants. In this, he just says the Brotherhood of Mutants, and he's not being entirely clear. When he's talking to someone who really fears mutants, and he says, "I think what you're afraid of is me and my kind, the Brotherhood of Mutants." I know that means he dropped the evil, but he's talking about his small group of mutants who fight for supremacy, who use violence against sapiens to further their political cause. But people who don't know it sounds like he just said that the guy is afraid of all mutants, which is probably true, but does that mean that what he just said is a name? When someone says Brotherhood, it's true that it can refer to a select group, but one thing I forget what it's called, but there's that song about Brotherhood of Man, and that's talking about human beings should help each other out. So when he says the Brotherhood of Mutants, is he saying that that all mutants stand together, and he's talking about all mutants. It just, it's so, and it's confusion that doesn't need to be there. I get dropping the evil in a comic book. You can call yourself and your group evil, and it's okay. But in real life, nobody says, "Here's me and my group." I know people find that frustrating about the trailers for Suicide Squad. Harley Quinn would refer to herself as one of the bad guys. That is, yeah. From my knowledge of her, I haven't read everything, but yeah. I'm the I'm not saying that they should necessarily have gone with the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants. I'm saying that's probably a case where some kind of retitling or just making it clear, but you need to do something. In a comic book, another thing is that when, yeah, someone just says, "This is my group, the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants," and in the movie, that's not, he's not going to stand there and say, "My group, the Brotherhood of Mutants," but you needed to do something. You needed to alter the line to, in some way, yeah, just something like, when he's talking about, me and my kind, the Brotherhood of Mutants, just when the conversation is happening, the entire group is assembled. So he could have just said, "I think what you're really afraid of is us, the four of us, the Brotherhood of Mutants," but the way it is just does not work. And I am aware that was harder to get out than I thought it would be. I am aware that in the comics they also dropped the evil after some time. In the comics, people knew what they, you know, they knew that the group was evil by, conventional. And they knew that they had been called the Brotherhood of Evil Mutants, and they knew that it was the name of a group where, again, here, yeah, it sounds like he's talking about every mutant. And when Xavier, it's the same problem with the other team. When Xavier explains, when he title drops, when he says the X-Men, which is the name of the team that go on missions, he's saying, he's talking, he's just been talking about the school and, how he's gone into both the school and the team. But they're the, just as he's saying X-Men, he's talking about a student of the school. And he says, yes, stay, if this student wants to, after she's graduated, she can stay on, teach others, become part of what the student, what the children have affectionately called X-Men. Does that mean that it's, are we talking about just, yeah, is it the team as it is in the comics? Is it the faculty? That's the film also doesn't really make clear if absolutely everyone, that's really the movies never did quite specify. Is every team member also a member of the faculty and vice versa? Because there might be some that are incredibly qualified to teach, but just don't really have a mutant power that is especially conducive to being part of the team, to going out and fighting. Maybe they're just not the kind of person who wants to go out and fight, but they like to teach, or vice versa. And yeah, in the comics, at first, it was basically Xavier who was the teacher, and the team were all teenagers, because the books are read by teenagers, and, you know, they were going off the logic that teenagers would have an easier time relating to other teenagers, which is also a huge part of why there are, you know, sidekicks, you know, because Batman, Superman, and so on and so forth are adults, so they have to have some teenager to tag along. That ended up sounding kind of dismissive. I'm not saying that they only tag along, but they were initially created with the, you know, to give the youth someone to very specifically, very directly relate to, where, you know, they've since gone on to do greater things, but they did start out as just, well, we can't, you know, Batman can't be a teenager, nor can Superman, so we have to, you know, well, actually, I'm not 100% certain. I think it was important to the creators of Superman that he also have a job. But, yeah. And, you know, when Batman and Superman were created, there was less of an... Yeah, they were fine with just making adult superheroes. I'm slightly rusty on comics history, but I believe that came later. Batman and Superman being two of the oldest superheroes in comic books. That originated in comic books. When Blade and the Matrix came out, they created a new look for action films. Tight black leather, stoic badasses who don't talk very much, or in the case of the Matrix sequels, talk far too much. But, yeah, who don't talk too much, and... Yeah. That works really well for those two properties. But not too much really here. In the Matrix, the characters do all, like, there's expression to their different, you know, costumes, what they wear, but it does all boil down to, you know, this is what you might buy, you know, if you had the money and you really wanted to look fancy, but the you know, here we have a lot of very distinct and different characters, and, you know, with very different mutations and mutant powers, and, you know, the X-Men world also have a lot of different locations, and, yeah, so on and so forth, and it's just... I suppose you could say that basically everyone dresses in bright colors, and, you know, nobody underdresses in the X-Men, again, traditionally speaking. You know, there are toned down versions. And yeah, that really makes a really big impact on the look here, that they wear black leather as uniforms, and it just doesn't fit the way it does in those, you know, in Blade and the Matrix, which were very much... I haven't read a lot of Blade. He guested on with Spider-Man once, so I've read that story. Yeah, for those who don't know, huge Spider-Man fan. He was the one who got me into comics. the or transitioned me into, you know, I read like Donald Duck stuff when I was a kid, but when I became a teenager, yeah, Spider-Man and then the X-Men and others, of course. But I'm aware that in the comics, Blade has a very different had a very different look originally. But the movie Blade and the sequels, it fits, because at the end, you know, yeah, vampires and black leather, and yeah, that works, and the Matrix as well. But yeah, here it just, one thing I do really appreciate is that there are touches that really, the character of Storm has, you know, her uniform, it's not quite a cape, but she has something that, you know, these things that kind of connect this sort of cape to her wrists, so that when she raises her arms, you know, it follows along and gets, you know, and they did put that in here, and, you know, it works okay. You know, us fans appreciate it. I do think they did a good job selecting what mutants to incorporate in this. Both teams, both the X-Men and the Brotherhood, are represented fairly well, with some iconic members present and, you know, acting in character. I'll get more into the detail of that, but briefly, there are some that are, what's the term, conspicuous with their absence, but there were mostly reasons for that, for ending up like that. And when it comes to the Brotherhood, they also have very clear roles and jobs on the team. It's actually, thinking about it, the team of the X-Men are not that compelling as, like, giving orders and having very specific, like, they're some of the time they do okay, but it really, I guess, more or less the bad guys tend to have better and more detailed plans, and then the X-Men just try to stop those plans. But yeah, there are a number of times in these films where, what is that character even supposed to be doing? The Brotherhood, it could very easily have ended up feeling arbitrary as to what they're supposed to be doing. But and this is, again, the movie doesn't sit, you know, there's no scene in this movie where the Brotherhood sits down and explains to each other, so that the audience can hear, what are we doing and how. You see something happen, and then you see one of the members of the Brotherhood in a certain situation, and then you realize that character's, and, you know, responsible for doing that, and they've done this or that before to prepare, and so on and so forth. And that's also something, the action scenes, there are a few times where this, you know, gets, you know, just people saying, should we do this, can we do that, and, but largely they act, although at times the X-Men very much just react to what the Brotherhood is. Yeah, I saw someone online say that the X-Men team, other than Wolverine, are just constantly getting their asses kicked. And there's some truth to that. And both sides have cool and really powerful mutants, and all of them get at least some, you know, yeah, some great action, which not all the films in this franchise get, you know, gets that right, and some of the best movies in this franchise don't actually accomplish that. And you believe that the Brotherhood turned out evil, the, you know, already gone into Magneto's backstory, the other three, you know, their appearance scares people, so they've, of course, had bad experiences on account of that. And they do also, you know, they look scary to us as well, which I suppose is kind of the movie having its cake and eating it too. You get the idea that these did not start out evil. You don't get a lot of backstory on, well, really any of them. You know, Magneto's, we don't know a ton of details, but what we know speaks volumes. But yeah, you do get the sense that they actually, you know, yeah, they've had bad experiences that led to them, you know, joining the Brotherhood. And we do see that all four members are quite sadistic, which is of course also movie shorthand for evil. And there are very much characters we love to hate. The various relationships that we see in detail, at least, more or less match the comics, and, you know, the rivalries play out and such. This has some humor to it. It could definitely have more, but they were afraid of not being taken seriously. The humor is somewhat hit and miss, and there are some in-jokes. The score is really great. It really captures the mystery, the threat, the outlandish nature, and how powerful some of the mutants are. And the effects are pretty good. You can tell they were on a budget, but when it needs to look, you know, to have a real, like, you know, they all have big moments with their powers, and when those, yeah, all of those look good. The makeup is also quite good, and, you know, one of the most obvious examples of the makeup effects in this are, of course, on Mystique, who is blue and naked. And as the special effects people point out in, you know, DVD, you know, featurettes and such, it doesn't look like her skin has been painted blue. It looks like her skin is naturally blue. I feel I must address CinemaSins' common claim that, you know, the movie's making it out as though, you know, as though Mystique isn't attractive. Is, you know, that plenty of people would still want to, you know, to be with her, have sex with her. I'm not gonna, you know, obviously Mystique, you know, in comic books, quite a few, you know, the major, like, heroes and villains often do look, you know, exceptionally attractive. And, you know, they did cast Rebecca Romijn Stamos. As they cast, you know, they cast attractive people for most of the, you know, and then some of them they made less attractive with, you know, like I said, to make them look scary. And, yeah, so it is, you know, a model, and she is, you know, she looks like she's naked. But quite a few people choose their partners based on preconceived notions. I'm not gonna get into the Mr. Epsilon thing that's recently, yeah. And, you know, it leads some people to try to hide, you know, who they are, hide parts of their appearance. You know, there's a lot of judgment around, you know, choice of sexual partner. For some time, AIDS was known as the gay disease. And I say the following without judging any of these things, even if it sounds like I am. Mutants represent a number of different, you know, members of different groups. You know, teenagers with angst and kind of being broody, coping with, you know, a lot of powerful emotions and sudden physical changes, feeling that the world revolves around them, and when something bad happens, they're the victim of it. Any minority, you know, sexual preference, gender identity, ethnic, age, religion, maybe they act on something they feel compelled to do. Maybe they can't physically hide it. Maybe it's gotten worse with time. Maybe they can't live up to the expectations placed on the group. Maybe they wish they could get rid of it. It maybe deeply affects the relationship, their relationship with their family, their friends, the world in general. And we do definitely see they are very, very much hated, with few coming to their defense. And, you know, everyone can relate to feeling different from everyone else, ironically. And, you know, it goes into diversity, tolerance, exclusivity. And since this has to introduce a lot of characters, we don't know the history of all of them, and some of them we know very little about, but everybody gets some definition. But, you know, the fact that, you know, Storm coming from, you know, Kenya, you know, they try with the accent, but, you know, the accent could just mean that when she grew up in America, she was in an area where it was most, you know, maybe she mostly spoke to her parents, and they still have the accent because they were immigrants. You know, in the comics, she was born and grew up, so, yeah, and that's not, you know, and that there was supposed to be, that was supposed to be one of the scenes of powers manifesting, but I do feel like they should have had, I'm almost certain there's no line in here that just says, you know, just briefly, when I grew up in Kenya, something, you know. As others have pointed out, this is very much, you know, their powers make them able to be heroes, but they wish they could be normal. And I've already brought up Spoonie's review of Wolverine Origins. To briefly address, he doesn't really accept the, you know, yeah, the kind of the bigotry as represented in, you know, and he says it doesn't fit in with the you know, there are tons of people of heroes who have superpowers in the Marvel universe who aren't mutants, and people don't distrust them, but mutants they do. That is an issue, I would agree. A comic book issue. I'm not even the first person to make that joke. A show is titled after it. But yeah. The idea of the bigotry itself, I would, yeah, I agree that it's a problem that it exists within the overall Marvel universe, where plenty of these heroes are completely accepted, but nevertheless, there are plenty of people who are, you know, if they are different in some way, such as, you know, in a way that I've just listed, you know, they are hated in spite of the good they do, blamed for the, you know, evil things done by others in their group, whereas, you know, people not in that group are, you know, are called heroes for doing the same or sometimes much less. You know, white guy with a gun and or a grudge, patriot, American hero. An innocent black person clearly targeted by police, thug, deserved what he had, you know, deserved what happened to him. You know, there was recently a story where on the Young Turks they pointed out, usually they, you know, when black people, you know, when they just react, when they aren't, when they don't do every single little thing that the police tell them, even if what they're doing is natural, maybe they're scared because the cop is clearly being irrational and angry when there's no actual problem. If they react and then the cop, you know, shoots them or is otherwise violent to them, it doesn't always end in, you know, they don't always draw their gun, but they'll, you know, they will physically assault them or use the, you know, use their taser or something. And then, you know, people say, oh, well, he should have just been calm. He should have done, you know, so of course the cop had to react like that. Now there's just been a story where a black woman, you know, sees the assault and then she does remain calm in spite of that. And then people are saying, oh, how can she be so calm? She must not care at all. So, regardless, there's, you know, there's apparently, they're doing something wrong. And this, again, does, you know, something, again, that not all the films in this franchise do, is that there are several mutants on both sides, and all of them use their powers more than once, and in at least one cool and memorable way, accomplishing something. And, you know, in general, too many bad comic book adaptations get this wrong. And an issue with this and the entire franchise is there are too many too powerful mutants, so some of them have to be written out of action scenes. Sometimes, you know, not just briefly, but entire action scenes. And there are several really cool cameos fans can easily recognize from what they look like. Well, I'm talking about from the comics. There are also actual, real life people cameos, including, of course, Stanley. But and if I recall, this was apparently like the first one where he, so that's cool. But yeah, the mutant characters and in general, X-Men characters from the comics, we can recognize them from what they look like, or maybe we see them use their power just briefly once or something. And then there are others that look like, and then we theorize about is that person that, and this was largely disproven by the sequels, but it was still a nice touch. And I would prefer that we were later disproven than that these characters just don't show up in the movies. And some of the really obvious ones that we were surprised weren't in this movie were, of course, Beast and Nightcrawler, and they were cut for budget, and that makes sense. And really, we get them in movies 2 and 3, and they're among the high points of those, especially of 3. But it's also, I feel like if Beast had been in this movie, Nightcrawler as well, but Beast is this very calm character who a very educated, and I figure they probably wouldn't have let us see very much of it. He would They would have tried to cover up his, like we'd only just get to see like the hands and the face and such as, in the, very recognizable blue and furry form. And yeah, as it is, by the time we get Beast in the third movie, and also just Nightcrawler in the second movie, we get to see much more of them. And they, yes, I do believe that if Beast had been in this one, in spite of Mystique being naked, I still believe they would have covered Beast up, because we're supposed to, he would have a lot of lines, and he would be saying complex, smart things, and we'd have to take that seriously, and they would be too afraid to, yeah. Really, the Mystique, it's just that she's, threatening the with without actually, just when she's standing still or she's barely moving, she's still incredibly threatening, and that you can do with someone who's blue and naked. Moving into the specifics of the details, Wolverine. I already mentioned that I'm, one of the stereotypes who got hugely into this character. For years, I actually sported the sideburns as they look in the comics, to the extent that I could. If you watch my earlier videos, which I sympathize if you do, but yeah, if you're wondering, yes, that's why I have the yeah. And I know it doesn't look that good. I was too into having that at the time to, yeah. Basically he has amnesia. It's for 15 years he's been going around without remembering what happened before then, and just trying to avoid not really settling down anywhere. And this movie series is very much the Wolverine show, and I am glad that they did, you know, with as big problems as I have with First Class and Apocalypse, at least they didn't, you know, it's not constantly Wolverine. Yeah. And it also, it makes a lot of sense that he would be chosen for the lead as such a beloved character, also a major character in the 90s cartoon show, and big in the comics. You know, he really, he drew a lot of fans when they introduced in the comics, and yeah. And the darkness of the character is on display, not shied away from, as a lot of other things from the source material. He's introduced fighting in cage matches to get by. Like, before we even really see his face, we just, you know, we see his opponent be dragged off, you know, couldn't even walk away or crawl. No, he's being dragged off. And then we hear the announcer basically say, you know, he's getting the crowd riled up. He's like, are you gonna let this man walk away with your money? So, yeah, you know, he's been there for, you know, hours maybe, fighting one person after another for money. So, you know, there's in X-Men War Origins Wolverine, he also uses his physical strength to make a living very early on in the movie, but he's seen as a lumberjack. And this, yeah, he genuinely, and you know, once, not long after that, we realize that he actually has several huge, you know, he has, you know, his mutation gives him some real advantages over, you know, so it's not even a fair fight against these guys, but you know, he knows how to, you know, it's that, you know, he's the best at what he does, and what he does, but what he does isn't very nice. And yeah, it's he is literally beating up other people for money to get by. And you know, we don't spend a lot of time watching the cage matching. Not long after, we see him attacked by bigots, and he very quickly and easily disarms them without injuring them. But it's clear that he would, at the very least, injure them, quite possibly kill them. He's got one of them. He's got one of the claws right to his throat. And yeah, he would injure, perhaps even kill, these who are no longer threats. They could have harmed him, but he disarmed them. And if they had attacked him, you know, they don't know this, but they would have had a really difficult time actually killing him. But nevertheless, he just barely makes the decision not to. And I'm not going to give away why he makes that decision, but yeah. And the initially, he shows almost no regard for Rogue, who we empathize with greatly. We meet her before we meet him, and we know, you know, we know more about her situation by the time, you know, we quickly piece together, okay, so he's going around, he's doing stuff like cage matches to get by, and she actually, yeah, she basically tries to hitch a ride with him without having asked him. And when he realizes this, he literally just leaves her there. He stops very soon after and lets her, you know, gives her a ride. He doesn't even, like, turn around, drive her back to where they were. He leaves her in the middle of nowhere. And it's not like, it's not a prank. It's not like he makes the decision to leave her behind and then soon after changes his mind. There's, you know, he's a very hardened character, and the, you know, the filmmakers trusted us to, you know, accept that, to not, you know, I mean, this is a character that could easily have been absolutely hated if, you know, if we didn't accept that he had, you know, he didn't just make the decision from one day to another to, you know, he is a hardened character. He, some of it, you know, without giving anything away, but, you know, you can tell that, yeah, he's experienced some really awful things, and that has made him hardened. He didn't just one day decide, I'm gonna go beat people senseless for money and, you know, yeah, treat with no regard 17-year-old girls. You know, it, yeah, but this is a character that you could easily see, like, studio executives say, no one's gonna, you know, sympathize with this character. I mean, Blade is a badass, yes, but one of the very first things you see Blade do in that first movie is genuine, like, he's very merciful and takes a great risk when he didn't have to. And there's just, and Blade, right from the, you know, the moment we meet Blade, we see him fighting evil. He is introduced as, he saves someone right at the very start, even before the moment of mercy. So there's, you know, he's tough and he doesn't show emotion and such, but he's also very clearly the good guy. When we first meet Wolverine, If you go into this blind and you know, not even watching trailers and such, you know, I mean, not that you think he'd join the Brotherhood, but there's a real chance that he's just, in spite of the fact that he could very clearly help out, that he is not going to help the cause. He is, you know, so, yeah, and all of that is actually in the movie. That really, I was ecstatic when I saw that. Now, the claws can vary in length. They can vary in thickness. And sometimes they are, you know, sometimes they are more like blades. Some interpret them more as these, like, long, like, almost like long fingernails, the way that, you know, Sabretooth has. But before this movie, I hadn't seen them quite like this in very many cases. They are freaking steak knives. The man has three steak knives between his, you know, that he can retract, and, yeah, between his knuckles. The how could they possibly fit? They're practically the size of his actual arm. You'd expect them to like poke out, to not, you know. How could he move his wrists when they're that, you know, they would have to go all the way up into the, yeah, it really, it doesn't make sense, and I love it. Not long after he is first introduced, he is rendered unconscious. And we then see him be prepared for, you know, basically medical, you know, just kind of very straightforward. Like, it's, yeah, you know, not something major, but, you know, some kind of, like, yeah, I'm not going to give it away either. And he wakes up very suddenly and unexpectedly. He grabs a, you know, a medical person. In this case, it's a woman. And I guess originally it was supposed to be Beast, which I guess either it would have been like, there would have been a short fight, or Beast would have just like backed off and said, you know, I'm not going to hurt you, or something. But yeah, it would have been a very different scene. Yeah. Moments later, he rushes out of the room, and he's now disoriented in this, you know, advanced facility with, you know, trying to escape and not knowing where he is or how much time has passed since he was last conscious. And this is intentionally very reminiscent of a major event in his origin story. Hugh Jackman is perfectly cast. He was such a find. And, you know, I just briefly, apparently there's going to be one more solo movie and then they might not do more. I do kind of hope that's it. We've gotten the real Wolverine in several films now, and it's just, I feel like they need to put the spotlight decisively on other characters now. And I could definitely see, you know, given the post-credit scene of Apocalypse, I'm into what they appear to be doing with the next Wolverine solo movie. And I also very much hope that they don't recast him, because he's been in several different, you know, he's, yeah, like the, you know, we've seen him as a kid in one of these, but otherwise, the moment the character is an adult, Hugh Jackman has always played him, no matter how old he was at the time and when the movie was set. You know, even if, you know, that doesn't necessarily make sense, shouldn't he look younger, but it's still been him, and I really do hope that they stick to that. Yes, pun intended. And there's also, you know, yeah, it's possible that they really will, because it, yeah, I don't see how they could find anyone else who would, yeah. And, you know, this was also the role that, of course, introduced Jackman to everyone, or everyone who doesn't follow Broadway. So, yeah, everyone. Doug Ray Scott, or is it Doug Ray, whatever, was apparently originally, he was originally cast, but then, like, because of schedule conflict with, you know, Mission Impossible 2. Yeah. He was replaced by Jackman several weeks into filming. I don't dislike Doug Ray Scott, but I am really glad. There is no way he could have been as good of a Wolverine. No way. And the... Yeah, to get into the mutation, he has a healing factor, and he, you know, there are different, like, yeah, some say that he, you know, didn't originally have claws, but some say that he did, but in this, the claws are made of adamantium, a supposedly indestructible metal which covers his entire skeleton, and the only reason he could survive having his entire skeleton encased is because of his healing factor. And he has these wolf-like, you know, superhuman senses of, you know, smell, of hearing, yeah. And yeah, he is one of our two protagonists, and the other, as already mentioned, is Rogue. You know, 17 years old, she leaves Mississippi after this, you know, she kisses her boyfriend, he ends up in a coma, which I'm pretty sure is, you know, fairly certain, it's Mississippi law that, you know, the response to that is, you know, pitchforks and, yeah. So she, yeah, she runs away from home and breaks off contact. In one of the deleted scenes, which, you know, it's you know, technically not canon since it's a deleted scene, but it's also not contradicted by anything in the film, says that she's been on the run for 8 months. She absorbs the memories and life force when she touches other people, and this is automatic. And she is, of course, terrified of her mutant power, but she's still a teenager, she has a sense of humor. Once she gets in the car with Logan, she does not stop talking. The you know, and they do get some drama there as well. It's not just, like, comedic, but when you really, like, you know, yeah, legitimately does not stop talking. And again, she just met Wolverine. She knows that he cage match fights to get by. You know, maybe other things as well, but that's what he's just been doing. You know, he made a lot of money beating people up, and she's just seen his claws, still does not stop talking. And, you know, she's a very sweet character and clearly misses positive human contact. In the comics, she has the psyche of Miss Marvel, who by now is finally getting into the MCU, so yeah, that's probably not going to happen in an X-Men movie. And the powers of an alien race known as the Kree, which is flight and superhuman strength. Yeah, I can understand why that isn't, you know, that suddenly makes her, she's still can't directly physically touch anyone without, you know, but she's suddenly less relatable for teenagers. And the with, yeah, both Wolverine and Rogue are, you know, in addition to protagonists, they are the kind of protagonists who are also a viewer proxy. We, you know, Wolverine knows he's been a mutant, you know, for at least those 15 years, but they are both new to the actual conflict. You know, no one knew that there were, you know, groups out there of mutants who, the you know, the senator talks about, well, they might be dangerous, but he's not talking about like small, you know, actual terrorist groups. You know, might not have used that. Well, I'm not certain if this came out before or after 9/11, but that's what they are. You know, they're not the military of a country, although in the comics, Magneto. But yeah, the you know, he's talking about, well, what if one of these kids with a lot of powers decided they suddenly want? He's not talking about there's an actual group of four powerful mutants who use violence to get their way and, yeah, fight, you know, sapiens who, yeah. And then on the other hand, you have the X-Men, a team of Homo sapiens who do fight for sapiens. So, did I just say of Homo superior who do fight for sapiens? So, you know, this whole conflict, the fact that it's not just a bunch of people here and there who have, no, they, you know, there are groups. That's new to both of them, and to her, you know, being a Homo superior is completely new. She, you know, how better to make us understand a Homo superior than to, you know, give us a character who turns out to be one. You know, she didn't know she was, she didn't mean to become part of this, you know, but suddenly we have, you know, we're invested in the struggle. Even if you go into the movie not really caring about Homo Superior, you know, yeah, we can't help but sympathize with Rogue. Now, and I should, Wolverine is also known as Logan, and Rogue, I may have already mentioned, her name is Marie. And that brings us to Scott Summers, or Slim, as he was. I just reread a few of the original. It was originally, yeah, in the 60s, that was a name. Not today. Not today. Scott Summers, also known as Cyclops. I really like Marsden, J James Marsden, I want to say it is. He is such a charming and funny presence. When he's not in character on DVD extras, his character is so boring and kind of annoying that there's not a lot of personality here, and then in Apocalypse they finally gave him some, and then he just becomes even more irritating. Nostalgia Chick points out he's basically the, you know, she was talking about the cartoon, but you know, it is so in, you know, cartoon comics and this, he's basically kind of, you know, the more sensible and calm, where Wolverine is the wilder, you know, so he's basically the straight man, and yeah, it's, I'll admit, in the comics, I don't remember there being that much, like, yeah, he's just kind of, he's the leader, can sort of, yeah, I'll link to, I already recorded some where I go into how I feel his character could be. Yeah. He's, you know, he in part works as a mechanic on, you know, the vehicles that the team have, and he is the second in command and the field leader of the X-Men. And he accomplishes very little as either. People are constantly disregarding his orders, and he's giving bad orders at times. They lessened his, skills from the comics, but he is still a pilot. He can sort of fight. In the second one, we see that he can fight at least a little bit. And the... Yeah, in the comics, he is also, well, yeah, and he's tactician. He knows tact. And in the comics, he also has greater spatial awareness. His mutation gives him concussive blasts that, you know, out of his eyes, and he can't turn them off. He can stop them with ruby quartz. And, you know, when he's not on a mission, he just uses sunglasses that have that. And on missions, he has a visor which allows him to adjust the strength and choose exactly when to shoot. And they are giant and ridiculous in this. They do make them much, much smaller in, you know, in the second one onwards, thankfully. But yeah, in this, it's this giant. Some of the design work here, it's probably because they were pretty rushed. And yeah, but some of what ends up in the movie just looks awkward. He is engaged to Jean Grey. There's a really great exchange between him and Wolverine that really sums up the, you know, the blockbuster rusher points out, it sums up their relationship. I'm not gonna quote it here, but I will say apparently on, you know, on the cable network effects, if I recall, it was apparently changed into him into Wolverine calling him a dork. That's pretty funny. I like that a lot. Yeah, when you know, censorship leads to, yeah, just the that's such a juvenile thing for Wolverine to call him. But yeah, and of course he is the third part of the love triangle, you know, Logan, Jean, and Scott. And not only are love triangles such a tired cliche, I'm aware it's not just the movie, it's in, you know, in the comics as well, but I don't think it needed to be here. It's, you know, it's one of those things that just, yeah, and it just, it makes Logan kind of an ass because they're clearly happy together. The, you know, they more or less saved his life before the, you know, by the time he genuinely meets them, they have just, yeah, and this is how he repays them. I mean, there is some, like, hint that Jean does, you know, he's not just, you know, there is some kind of attraction there, but yeah, it just, you know, and he also just got, you know, the circumstances of his situation just greatly changed. And if he doesn't really, you know, if he doesn't leave and he behaves, then he has a huge improvement on what his life, you know, yeah, the way he gets by and such, if he stays with the X-Men. And right off the bat, he just starts flirting with, yeah, it just, and in this, Jean is a doctor, which also makes, and again, you know, yeah, she's doing what she can to help him, and then he's, this, you know. Yeah. In addition to being a doctor in this, Jean is also seen working on some machinery and such. But yeah, basically her character was combined with, or given the roles of Beast with, medical doctor who knows genetics and a political supporter of, human rights for Homo sapien, Homo superior. And she's very restrained because she's very powerful and has some trouble, kind of, yeah, it's said that she's incredibly powerful. She's a telepath, but nowhere near as powerful as Professor Xavier, and Xavier uses Cerebro to extend, excuse me, his telepathy, and it's said that if Jean were to try to use it, it would be dangerous. Telekinesis is another of her powers. Professor Charles Xavier, I like Captain Picard, but I do find that Xavier is much more willing to show his sense of humor and his heart. So I do prefer, yeah. And they did actually cast longtime fan favorite. His name escapes me at the moment, but yeah. And that, yeah, it's pitch perfect casting. He is an expert on genetic mutation, and he started and runs the school, Xavier's school. In this, they mostly just call it school for the gifted. It is actually for gifted youngsters, yes, again, in the 60s. And that is, you do see in at least one shot in this, you do see the what's it called, plaque on the front of the school, and yeah, it does say youngsters on there. And it's a place where Homo Superior can find refuge and get an education both on how to use their power and, actual education, college. And we don't really, as far as we see, the teammates are also faculty. We don't see any who are only one of those. And he is confined to a wheelchair, but yeah, immensely powerful telepath. And Cerebro basically allows him to scan the world for specific mutants and such. And he's also part of this movie having an incredibly talented cast for a film that the studio wasn't sure would even really work. Eric Lenscher, also known as Magneto, and briefly, the Lord of the Rings and Star Trek were not really part of my teen years, but yeah, the X-Men were. So yeah, in addition to being, Xavier over Picard, I am also Magneto over Gandalf when it comes to picking one, of the portrayals that Ian McKellen, yeah. And he He's a very passionate character. He hates Sapiens for the persecution he faced when people just looked at him and saw a Jew. Now they look at him and they see incredible power. And yeah. And McKellen manages to look dignified, powerful, and intimidating in spite of this, you know, wearing this suit and helmet that a lot of people couldn't carry, as it were. He controls metal at pretty good range, a number of meters, and the relationship between Xavier and Magneto, or the approach that the two take has been compared with that of Martin Luther King, contrasted with that of Malcolm X, which makes Malcolm X look a little, but then that's you know, the perception a lot of people have, that he was substantially more violent than, yeah. But the two are old friends. They built Cerebro together, and Charles tried to talk him out of the hatred, but was, yeah, unable to. And they have these fantastic dialogue scenes, and both characters also have monologues, and yeah, I absolutely love these. They really show the smarts of both characters, the history they share, and their vastly different perspectives. I quote them far more than I should, more than any other pop culture. Aurora Monroe, also known as Storm. I like Halle Berry. I don't think it's her fault that, yeah, that she's not that good here. She's trying to do this Kenyan African kind of accent, and it fits the character background, but like I said, that isn't really explained here, and it really mars her performance. She's so focused on how to pronounce the words to be geographically accurate, there's no room for her to add emotion to it. Her strongest acting moments are the nonverbal ones. There are a few times where her eyes are really expressive, and the way she moves her body sometimes. She has really forceful lines. She's supposed to be a passionate character. At one point, she admits that sometimes she hates Sapiens and just does not come across. Did I say that right? That sometimes she hates. Yeah, not in general, but yeah. And it just does not come across because of how, yeah. And the white hair really doesn't fit. And, you know, of all the things they could have changed, they really should just have given her a more, you know, I mean, they didn't make the clothes white the way they are in the comic. You know, it's, yeah. And but yeah, as a character, she's calm and caring, but also somewhat bitter over anti-mutant bigotry. She has mastery over the weather, the ability to conjure up and control storms, lightning, and the like. The Senator Kelly is the American senator who's fighting for the Mutant Registration Act. And to get into a little bit more detail on that, basically, it would ban mutants from schools and, you know, teachers as well as children. And basically register all mutant, you know, names and their powers, which is also, there's not a lot in the film that, you know, the Registration Act is mostly seen as the negative, you know, but, you know, there's a line, he compares, he says, the senator himself says, compares it to gun control, basically, that, you know, these are incredibly powerful, so we, you know, and, you know, it does make sense to, you know, if someone goes out and buys a lot of really dangerous, you know, the things you would, you know, I wish I could say that, you know, if you went out and bought guns that might, you know, if you buy especially many or especially much ammunition, but, you know, not so. But if you buy the materials to make a bomb, and it's very clear, you know, and it looks suspicious, yeah, you know, then that actually, that gets some attention, and, you know, there are certain people who are prevented from buying certain very destructive and dangerous things because they've shown that they will, you know, yeah, that they use them to, you know, it's not for recreation or whatever. They actually use it to harm people. Making just having the list of, you know, people who have powers, and just, you know, as long as you don't use it to, but just, you know, if, I don't know, just if it were only registering, if it were only just noting, okay, these people are really, really powerful, that doesn't mean you have to treat them differently. It just means, hypothetically, let's say that one of them actually does something criminal, then you can go in and say, okay, well, we've identified the person and we know it, you know, he's, in addition to what human beings could do and what his equipment, the equipment he has or whatever, he also has these powers, you know, just as a, I don't know, I guess maybe that is touchy also, but I could understand that more. It's the moment he gets into the banning stuff that's, but, you know, and another thing is, you do understand where this fear is coming from. Now, in the comics, the registration is also there, although apparently for a while, I don't remember reading much about it, but I haven't read everything. You know, it didn't start out as important the way, you know, here it is very much, yeah, you know, it would be a really big deal if this act were passed. In the comics, he's also known as Victor Kree, but here he's only referred to as Sabretooth. They cast the wrestler Tyler Mane, and he actually does pretty well. He, you know, he says that as a wrestler, you know, it's theater, you know, with no, like, he has to make it look good from every angle, because there can be people, you know, wrestling as theater. I'm not touching that one. But yeah, basically he's very animalistic bestial, and you know, he has a healing factor and then these wolf-like senses, you know, a predatory animal of that, you know, a wolf of a type, something in that, yeah. So some similarities to Wolverine. And basically here, like Mystique and Toad, you know, the three of them are just hench persons. Although, you know, there is some indication that maybe Mystique is more, means more than that. But they aren't just like, you know, marching around and doing, you know, both Toad and Mystique know how to fly a helicopter, and well, Sabretooth knows how to make things hurt real bad. And you know, in the they've changed these, you know, these three characters from the comics, but it does make sense, and technically a lot of the continuity isn't outright contradicted. It's just we don't, you know, it's not said, so it could, you know, yeah. But the you know, they needed to have the characters somewhat, you know, the in comic books, especially as there are a lot of issues, you can get to have more, you know, they can get to be more pronounced, and they can do things that, you know, but that's as there are a lot of issues. This was just one film that had to fit in almost a dozen major mutants, so they had, so yeah, they are just, you know, hench persons. Also, like I said, we don't see the Brotherhood sit and discuss a plan, so, you know, really, they don't talk much. It's almost always Magneto who does the talking, and like I said, he's the one we really understand, because the first thing we see in the movie is his genesis. And the, yeah, the, in the, but yeah, in, you know, he kills for fun, and in the comics he's also a mercenary, which I suppose we don't know if he believes in the cause here, or it's just that Magneto gives him a lot of people to brutalize. But you know, in the comics he has a connection and shares some history with Wolverine and their arch nemesis, and like I said, that is not technically contradicted here. They don't say that they don't have that, and like I said, Wolverine doesn't, you know, doesn't remember, so, and Sabretooth doesn't say anything, but when they interact, I feel like there might be some, he definitely does seem to really especially hate Wolverine. And the, basically, you know, both of them have these animal aspects to them, and where Wolverine tries to suppress and control his, Sabretooth very much embraces the animal inside. The Raven Darkholm, I'm sorry, she doesn't answer to her slave name. Brett Ratner. I'll get to him soon enough. Mystique very rarely speaks, but what she says speaks volumes. She tells the senator, people like you are the reason I was afraid to go to school as a child. That one line says so much, and just, yeah. The, you know, she can look, sound, and, you know, move, act like basically anyone, and this uses this shape-shifting power, this movie uses the shape-shifting power, you know, about as well as Terminator 2, and far, far better than Terminator 3. You know, she can sneak into secure locations, she, you know, sneak past people. In combat, she basically, she uses it to get really close to someone before she attacks. And it's, yeah, really, and, you know, she can actually fight. Mostly because the producers really liked the look, and so they added, you know, yeah, added fight scenes. And, you know, can you tell that this fight scene is added at the last moment? Absolutely. But it's awesome. I absolutely love the fight. The, in, you know, in the comics, she also has super agility, a healing factor, and, you know, does not age, so somewhat like Wolverine. And she has a child with Sabretooth. She is the father, yes, of Nightcrawler and once adopted Rogue. Even joined the X-Men at one point. And the, I read that, or reread, I believe I knew it already, but apparently, you know, she was going to be, supposed to be, the father of Nightcrawler, but, you know, they, that would mean that a female character, you know, in her natural form, she is female, and another female character would, you know, that would be the comic show, and, you know, censorship hated that. That would be the comics showing an openly gay relationship. I find it interesting that that's how they read it, rather than that a character transitioned from one gender to another, and then also, you know, a someone born a woman fathered a child. But yeah, I guess, yeah, when you're that, you know, what's that thing about when all you have is a hammer, everything you see is a nail. But that really is a very cool, you know, detail. I forget if it's later been retconned into that, or if it was just written as the original plan, and technically she is now just, or just, she is now the mother rather than the father. But yeah, basically, you know, Mystique being naked, you know, I'll link to, I've already talked about this some, but, you know, part of the reason is that, you know, yeah, guys can stare at her, and really, Bryan Singer doesn't exploit that particularly. In, you know, I think he kind of, he did some in Apocalypse, but not otherwise, not in the other X-Men movies he's directed. And, you know, Nostalgia Chick says, you know, she thinks that it's because he's gay. I would hope. I mean, there are at least some directors who can, you know, they can have a beautiful woman in a movie without turning her into a sex object. But yeah, but that's actually this has fairly equal, you know, equal opportunity for most, like, you know, The Brotherhood only has one woman and then three guys, but then Mystique, the one woman, is shown to be one of the most capable ones, one of the single most useful ones, and, you know, in part because of her power, but, yeah, and the X-Men, two men, two women, the students we see at the school, I think there might actually be... No, actually, I suppose that's about equal. Sometimes when we see them in class, there are more girls, but then we see other times when there are more boys. But, yeah, very equal opportunity, and no one is really particularly objective. Again, you know, Mystique, but the camera doesn't rest on it. You know, it's just, like, you know, I guess, yeah, just the idea that she is naked almost all the time, but when, you know, yeah, and she's actually in, rather, she is one of these very scary characters, but, yeah, the movie does really well, and again, the movie does have both men and women in tight black leather, so you would really expect it to, and, again, these incredibly beautiful young women, but... Yeah, it really, and again, that's a big thing in comic books. They tend to sexualize, you know, and yes, I know they draw men to be really muscular and such as well, but it's more a thing with women. But yes, that brings us to Toad, played by Ray Park, in one of the only movies where he gets to, where he isn't dubbed over, and, you know, yeah, and they do make a reference to him being Darth Maul as well, but, yeah, always enjoys, you know, he's one of the tolerable parts of X vs. Sever. You know, casting Ray Park, of course, allowed him to use martial arts. You know, in the comics, he does have some, like, you know, he will leap and, like, do certain, but he's not, like, traditionally, like, martial arts kind of, you know, Toad. He's fast and that kind of, you know, but, yeah. And they did, you know, they put a stomach on him, but he's not a hunchback here, and, yeah, they expanded, you know, they wanted to use the full range of Ray Park's, you know, yeah, abilities. In addition to martial arts, he's, I believe, also, like, a gymnast, so, yeah. And it really, it works out really well. He's a really, really cool, very... You know, yeah, really cool character. He's always, whenever he, you know, gets into an action scene, you know, it's fast, it's really, yeah, really, really cool. And the, you know, part of it was also, you know, in the comics, him being a hunchback is also more like, yeah, again, more acceptable, where in the movie it might not have fit the tone, and he's also really slimy and always sucking up to Magneto in the comics, and yeah, that really wouldn't have fit the tone. He doesn't say all that much either, but he does, he speaks in full sentences, and he has more lines, which Sabretooth, maybe Sabretooth can, he just chooses not to. He says very, very little. But, yeah, speaks full sentence and says more than Mystique does, but unless you count things Mystique says when she's posing as other characters. But when it's Rebecca Romijn, Stamos talking, yeah. But yeah, you know, I just reread at least part of, as much as I had time to, the original X-Men number 4, which I'm pretty sure is the first time Toad appears, and literally the one second. Yeah, pretty much, yeah, the first time he and Magneto are in the same place, Toad says something, and Magneto immediately says, "Stop your sniveling, Toad." So yeah, that was the idea they wanted to convey with that name. Yeah, and he also has this prehensile tongue that's also pretty long. And he can stick to walls that, yeah, there's, at one point, he spots a bird, might be a pigeon, I'm not sure, and just, you know, sends out his tongue, grabs it, and eats it with, you know, feathers and all. So, yeah. And that scene, just briefly, when the Brotherhood have a prisoner and they're waiting for Magneto to return and deal with the prisoner, and literally, like statues, the three members of the Brotherhood are standing in different, so like if the prisoner tried to run in any direction, they would very quickly be, you know, and they are just staying, like, yeah, Toad is like sitting, is like, you know, yeah, they have him in a Toad-like position, but the other two are just standing, waiting, and just, it's really, really creepy, and it's, again, a scene where you can really tell these are the bad guys, you know, even without them doing anything, without them saying anything. Yeah, this, you know, no one this creepy is one of the good guys, basically. That was a joke. He spits this slimy substance, and yeah, incredibly agile. And in the comics, all four of these characters are, you know, they're not all like regular members, but all of them have been in the Brotherhood. And the, you know, the Brotherhood being led by Magneto, yeah, that's, in fact, Magneto is the villain right there in the first one, and again, the fourth one of the original issues. And And that brings us to Bobby Drake, also known as Iceman, a student at the school, and he takes a liking to Rogue. In the comic, he is a full member of the team, including right there in the, again, the very first issue. And, you know, so, it, yeah, again, the very first issue, so is Jean Grey and Cyclops. They're also students, you know, all three of them are students in that comic, but, you know, again, that's at first, that's in the 60s, and, you know, so here they made Iceman distinctly younger than, because the others are adults, and, you know, he's one of the younger ones in the comic, but he's not that much younger, but, yeah, it makes sense that, you know, here the team has been around for a while, so the ones who were teenagers in, you know, the first comics have now, are now adults in this. And Beast would have been one of the original, although he wasn't originally fuzzy or blue. You know, Xavier was also always there from the start, and Magneto was the big, the nemesis of the team. And Iceman creates and manipulates, you know, cold and ice. And in the comics, he can make his whole body ice, or as it appeared in the first one's snow. and he can ride these ice slides that he also creates. This has a scene where, you know, one of the cameos is Kitty Pryde, Shadow Cat, who can walk through walls, which is also, you know, the senator says there's a girl here who can walk through walls, you know. But that's apparently in another, or maybe Kitty ran away from that. Anyway, the way they show this is that, you know, a class is just ending, and so the students walk away, and Kitty starts to walk away, but then she realizes I think she, like, accidentally forgot her bag or something like that. And so she walks back, grabs the bag, and then walks right through the door. And, you know, even if we weren't sure that, you know, it says Kitty, but if you weren't sure, yeah, that is Kitty Pryde. She walks right through the wall. I like that reveal, but it does kind of make the other students jerks. They saw that she was going back there, and they just closed the door when the, you know, yeah. In three films, Kitty Pryde has three different actors. And several of the X-Men are pushed to or even past their limits. The, you know, Cyclops will have his visor grabbed off him, and Jean will have to use her power with a lot of focus and strength. There's some really great dialogue. This does not tend to get bogged down in exposition, and like I said, they don't exposit about anything they don't need to, but there are things that need to be exposited about. The team has been around, you know, the X-Men have been around for a while. Like I said, we don't know much about the Brotherhood, but, you know, we some of Magneto's, you know, backstory has to be exposited about. The creation of the school, the start of the team. Yeah, these are things, and it handles them really well. A lot of the casting is really great. I have not seen the actors in this and an awful lot else, although I did, you know, like everybody else, I needed to see Hugh Jackman in more things. You know, we couldn't wait for the next X-Men movie. No, we, you know, they immediately cast him in other movies. And, you know, I, of course, watched at least several of those, not all of them, but several of those, and they weren't all awful. In general, you know, the acting is quite good when you think about, you know, you've got a Broadway star, several models, a wrestler, and a martial artist. The characters are flawed. It's very much Marvel's real people, not DC's idealized people. I see the value in the idealized, but I do prefer the real people. Which is not to say there's a lot of great DC as well. And as far as I hear, at least, this was basically only the second time a good movie was made from, you know, a major live action and major, you know, yeah. The Blade being the first, and the 89 Punisher, the 94 Fantastic Four, and I forget exactly when the Captain America, because there are so many, but yeah, as far as I hear, basically everything Captain America that was filmed that came before the 2011, I want to say, movie was bad, but yeah. And the, you know, the success of Blade, and to a greater extent this, really gave more faith in, you know, we really worried that Batman and Robin were going to kill it completely. You know, not everybody looked at that movie and saw the death of their favorite subgenre. Some just watched and saw, wow, that's an absolutely terrible movie. But yeah, some of us genuinely worried that we weren't going to get more of these movies when, you know, we had barely gotten any by then. You know, you have to, you know, it was pretty much just Batman. There was a little else, but yeah, it was pretty much just Batman from, you know, through the 90s. And then, you know, this really started, got the ball rolling on, yeah, with the, you know, the success of it led very directly to, you know, Spider-Man, Fantastic Four, Hulk, Daredevil. But we all make mistakes. And, you know, like I said, the MCU would not exist, or at least not in its current form, if not for the success of this movie. And Kevin Feige actually did apparently also work. He's listed as a producer, but I'm not sure. He's not in a lot of the DVD extras. And, yeah, I haven't heard of a lot that he very distinctly said, okay, this should be like this. You know, a number of the producers are very clearly, you know, yeah, in the, you know, very clearly helping refine ideas and such in the DVD extras. And, you know, this was before he quite had, you know, before he even got the idea, I think, to, yeah. And the, the movie does pretty well at showing, not telling, and when we first see the various powers used, we do get some idea of how the power works and, you know, what it, maybe what it can and can't do. And it's very clear that the crew working on this understood how the powers, you know, the details of them. Cyclops, you know, it's not a laser, it's not heat, it doesn't cause explosions, it's, you know, it's concussive blast, it's physical force. The effects designer compares it to waves crashing against something, and that's, you know, that is both in how it physically actually works, and also there's some, you know, some of that in some of the visual for it. And yeah, you know, and this was the, the, and yeah, the powers mostly look right. And yeah, this is the first time most of these had been done in live action. So, you know, what does it look like? And, you know, how what can they do on the budget? And, you know, what fits and what will we accept? What will just the average viewer who doesn't know the comics, what will they accept? And what does it sound like? What does something look like that has been shot with a concussive blast or the like? And among the many cool uses of mutant powers is Magneto ripping open the roof of a train like a kid at Christmas with wrapping paper, just tears right through it. There's no, like, he's there for something specific and he goes to get it. He doesn't care how it really, yeah, and it's terrifying looking. And the, you know, he also, there's basically, you know, there's a point where he's facing, like, police and SWAT. And, you know, he's just left a building, and they were out there waiting for him. And he basically holds them at gunpoint with their own weapons, using, you know, using the metal in their weapon. Just rips the weapons right out. You know, one of them like holds on and gets like, you know, pulled to the ground and yanked a little, and eventually has to let go. You know, and yeah, he just, you know, they do the typical thing. You know, this is the police. Hands over your head now. And he just looks, please, you know, raises his arms and, you know, I mean, yeah, I'm not gonna say the first thing he does there because that's, you need to see that for yourself. But yeah, when he does that, he also starts to, yeah, tear their guns out of their hands. And, you know, he also makes a cry, you Homo sapiens and your guns. And yeah, just straight up points their own guns at them. And that's such a cool idea also. You know, it's something he can do with his powers. I forget if he's done quite that, or if he had done quite that before. You know, some of the things that were done in the movie were then later, you know, they tried to incorporate those in some of the comics that came after, so that, you know, people could be, oh, you know, that was the movie. Oh, here's the comic. Oh, hey, they follow up on some of the stuff, you know. But that's a really cool idea. You know, we've seen showdowns between someone and then a ton of police so many times in movies, you know, but to see them have the guns ripped from their hands and then be pointed back at them, you know, yeah, I hadn't seen that before in anything. And then there's also this part where Wolverine and and some others enter a room, and Wolverine, you know, says, "Get out." And they say, "What's wrong?" "I can't move because Magneto has him." Yeah, and he's, as he's saying that, he's also standing stock still and in kind of an awkward position. And at first you're not quite what's going, oh, and then yeah. And just the noise of when, you know, when he's bending metal as he can with ease, you know, the sounds that this all makes, just really well done. And again, something that other comic book movies get completely wrong. You know, the way it sounds when someone uses their powers. And, you know, some don't feel that this represents the comic, you know, does enough to represent the comic, but I would say that it does about as much as it could have. You know, this is the reason that a movie like Spider-Man can go all in. You know, in that he has the colorful costume, so does his, you know, nemesis. The nemesis is, you know, his nemesis is throwing bombs that melt, you know, melt people down to the skeleton. You know, that movie got to be so much bigger because this movie did well. You know, it was like, oh, people do want this. People will accept movies that, you know, okay, well, let's see if Spider-Man, the extremely popular comics character that everybody knows about, let's see if he can't as well. And it's really good that movies like this and Spider-Man and such were made when they were and not just years earlier, because it would have been such a different film, such the limitations placed upon it by just what special effects can do. It would really have greatly harmed, because some of these things you need to do with computers, and yeah, you cannot do all of the things in this with practical. On Rotten Tomatoes, this is certified fresh with 81%, and the viewer score is 83%. And that is in spite of several negative reviews from critics. But yeah, and I would say that is pretty accurate. I might personally be closer to 75 than 81, but yeah. But yeah, the movie was definitely on a budget, considering the amount of action and the genre, you know, big sci-fi action film for the summer, which, you know, that was a late decision. They weren't originally gonna be, but then suddenly, oh yeah, you're gonna be the big movie out in the, you know, and yeah, that, yeah. And it mostly hides the budget well. The exploration of the themes can be really on the nose at times, but, you know, it's not just, you know, we have to accept those are different, you know, some of the mutants are evil, not all of the, you know, and some of the mutants are kind of, you know, like I said, Magneto is a supremacist. And the, you know, so yeah, it's not except absolutely everybody. Some of these are incredibly dangerous and harmful. And not all sapiens are, you know, some of the sapiens do accept the mutants. The movie is never campy, although some have said that it's overproduced with makeup and costumes and has bland, dopey dialogue, and some of the time, yeah. And others point out that, you know, setting up the political context for the conflict is a first for a comic book film. And few of the characters get a lot of opportunity to hold our attention. And one thing critic point out that I really do think is very true. It is the result of a lot of rewrites from people whose ideas of how it should turn out were never in sync. And you really can tell, okay, this was what one, you know, excuse me, this portion, that was what one writer thought, and this other bit was, and that is, you know, I don't know if they could have done more to, by the time they, you know, it was a rushed production, so they probably couldn't have done much more than, yeah. But it does, you can tell. And some have pointed out it doesn't feel like a fitting kickoff for a big epic. It feels more like the so-so middle chapter of such. And it's too short. It's incomplete. Bryan Singer himself has said it's basically a trailer for the second movie. Some have said it's like the pilot of a TV series. Now, the action is good to great with a lot of really inspired standout moments, and it uses the powers involved quite well. And it, you know, I may have already mentioned, sometimes has to separate characters because they are so powerful, and you know, scenes would become incomprehensible if all of them used their powers at the same place at the same time. And, you know, there's the point that when they are so powerful, sometimes it seems like situations should be easily resolved. And you can tell that Singer hadn't really staged action before, you know, You might say, usual suspects, but that's all gunplay, and it's not really an outright action film. There, I mentioned the SWAT bit with the, Magneto levitating guns, but that's pretty much it for guns in this. But, that movie proved he could do an ensemble well. There are some kind of awkward moments in action. And, because he didn't really, there's a part where Wolverine can smell that someone is nearby, but he hasn't zeroed in on, who or where, and so he walks off. He walks back, moments later, and then something really cool happens. But between him walking off and walking back, the X-Men literally just stand there, kind of awkwardly staring in different directions, in order to find whoever's hiding or something. But really awkwardly just staring in a specific direction for a while, and then he walks back and, why don't they just walk a little bit into that direction and properly look? I get that maybe they don't want to split up, but do they also not want to move in any direction at all either? Why not just have Cyclops start to give an order and then be interrupted when Wolverine comes back? Or just, something. But yeah, there are other times where mutants just wait for, something to happen that the script says is going to happen before, rather than try to stop it. As one critic points out, it is thankfully free of banter during the fighting. And it's not a very violent film for, it could very easily have been a very violent film, but yeah, not particularly, and that also makes the violence hit harder. And this was before the PG-13 rating. Before movie makers started really pushing that as far as it could go. I love the, for the marketing, they weren't they needed to attract as many people and, again, people who hadn't who didn't know the comics and such. The trailer is just this ridiculous, like really trying to be hip and cool and badass, and it just does not match the movie at all. It's very clearly, because like I said, I love this film, but it's not this big, really cool, constantly moving, yeah, it's like I said, it's more this kind of somber and trying to it has the fashion sense and look, well, not look, it has the fashion sense of the Matrix, but not the look, the fascinating idea and the kind of mind-bending, and something like Blade also has a much more straightforward, so yeah, in order to attract as many as possible, they, yeah. I went into the gender equality earlier. It is true that neither team is led by a woman, but then really that doesn't happen an awful lot in the entire film franchise. But there are strong, important women in the various films. You know, I'm not sure that even has an exception, even in the worst of them. So there still is some, and you know, when it was written, I'm not sure it would have been as well. I suppose there were some women leaders of groups in comics. Some say that, you know, some of the really strong characters in this, like Sabretooth, are sometimes made to like look foolish and such. And yeah, it's true that there are times like this, but they're really, it's like when they, you know, in the MCU, when they deal with characters like Thor, the way I see it, you have to have something, and I guess Terminator 2 is one of the earliest examples of this, and one of the best, you know, it's a real case study in that, taking a character who's extremely powerful and imposing and that we are meant to take seriously, but also having some humor about it so it doesn't become just, you know, so it doesn't get to be too much, where, you know, in Terminator 2 we have the return of Arnold Schwarzenegger's Terminator, and immediately we have some real fun moments where when you watch the first movie, it's almost like a slasher flick. And there's, you know, he's cool and he's impressive and he's smart, but we don't really laugh at him. We are terrified of him. And I mean, I love that movie, and I wish there were only the one Terminator movie. And I'm not saying the Terminator 2, the movie, shouldn't exist. I'm saying I wish that it was just, it was something else, and people would be like, oh, hey, this movie is a lot like that Terminator movie that James Cameron also made. Oh, well, they're similar. That's it. But yeah, I'm not going to get into it here. But basically, bringing Arnold Schwarzenegger's Terminator character back, you almost had to relieve, it's about pressure, you have to relieve some pressure, some tension, and if every single time we see this strong character, they're just intimidating, then it just becomes really tense. And I don't know, I guess some people, I don't mean this as a bad thing, but I guess some people just don't see it that way, or don't, I know a lot of people, a lot of, you know, vloggers that I like who say that they couldn't take, what's it called, Ultron seriously, for example, because he jokes. And I'm like, yeah, he jokes. He also takes a guy's arm clean off without even trying to. I don't understand how you can look at the MCU Ultron and not be scared of him. He's creepy, he's intimidating. Yeah, he quips and sometimes gets lost in his big speeches, but without it, it would just be intolerable. And I can appreciate if you think it went too far, that I can understand, but not being able to take the character seriously, we are speaking two different languages. And that's the thing with Sabretooth in this, he's such a badass, and he's, yeah, like, I think he has four lines, and two of them are about how he wants, I'm not going to give away who, but he wants a woman to scream for him. He's such a sadist. If you don't have anything where we can lighten, relieve some of the tension regarding that, it would just be absolutely, and yeah, he remains this really badass, and this really strong, you know, he's a force to be reckoned with throughout the film. He is, you know, when he and Wolverine fight, it's, yeah, like, Wolverine is in real danger. And again, remember, the first time we see Wolverine, he is mopping the floor with big, muscular guys who, you know, and this is after he's been fighting for hours. So, you know, he's been fighting for a while. Certainly he's gotten a lot of money out of it, and the audience is really, like, they want to see this guy get taken out, you know. And one of the things about Sabretooth that I love, one of the times he enters a scene, he literally drops down from above, and just this, you know, just this really badass landing, where it's like, you know how a cat always lands on, you know, he lands perfectly, and it's like, I don't know, 20 meter drop maybe, and he just lands perfectly, smoothly. They put that in the fighting game that came out around the same time, you know, X-Men Mutant Academy. Whenever he, you know, when a fighting game starts, it, well, I guess, yeah, some do, some don't. In some fighting games, the character will, you know, first you see the stage, and then the character moves in, you know, makes an entrance to the stage, and then the other character makes an entrance, then they fight. His entrance is to jump, you know, to land, and the impact, and just, yeah, such, so badass. And, you know, like I said, he has maybe four lines. He's not silent for the rest of it all of the time. He will growl, he will roar, and yeah, he's just incredibly intimidating. One thing I do wish, it's again this kind of design decisions and such. They give him these nails that kind of, they look kind of fake. It's, you know, he doesn't have claws the way Wolverine does, but he has these longer fingernails that are, yeah, you know, he's incredibly sharp, incredibly dangerous. And they, you know, he has like these fake eyebrows also, and it again just, yeah, it's just doesn't quite look. Yeah. Now, this is the end of the video, so I'm less worried, excuse me, about losing viewers, whether they, you know, so this is where I will go into stuff that a lot of people can't stand. I love Spoonie's work. But what Spoonie and Cinema Snob say that I've responded to earlier in this video kind of betrays their straight white male cis privilege that they just did not check when doing those videos. And it's especially obnoxious with Cinema Sins because he says this maybe every other time he makes a video about X-Men. And yeah, that's, you know, I realize I just lost most of the viewers. Either literally they clicked away, or figuratively they ceased to agree with what I was saying, refusing to care about the problems of people worse off than they are. Oh well, I'm Danish. It means you can eat me. I've reviewed other parts of this franchise. The links are in the description box. Please comment, thumbs up, and subscribe for more content.